kernel of every culture is gastronomic. The person who wrote that was the French anthropologist Edgar Morin. The history of a nation's table is a reflection of a nation's civilization. The person who wrote that was the French chef Auguste Escoffier. Are the assertions true, or are they special pleading, the French defining other nations according to a specifically French criterion? Run into problems with Escoffier's dictum. For the British seldom eat at table. They mostly eat anywhere else. Their eating habits derive from the fairground. We're surrounded by fast food. We can't escape it. It's inside us and outside us. It's like pop music, ubiquitous, unbidden, all-pervasive. And even when we're not eating it, we can see it. Or we can see representations of it, adverts for it, exhortations to buy some, stuff some in. And when we're neither eating it nor looking at it, we can smell it. Fast foods is the noxious stench which defines our era. It is our tallow, our coal gas, our sewage. And it's about as fragrant as coal gas, about as enticing as the sewage it will become. We breathe it just as we tread in it. It turns us into passive eaters. No, I don't. Well, not if I don't have to. But I frequently have no option. This is, after all, Britain in the early 21st century. Britain in the early 20th century so different? This nation's appetite for fast food goes back a long way. All that's new is the name and the increasing variety of such foods. The first fast food was fish and chips. The earliest fish and chip shops opened in the East End of London in the mid-19th century. Till then, deep frying was a cooking method that was barely known in this country. This quintessential British dish, the so-called national dish, was introduced by Sephardic Jews. Sephardi derives from a Hebraic word for Spanish. And deep frying is an old Spanish practice. The indigenous frying agent is olive oil. Indeed, it was olive oil's ubiquity and cheapness which prompted the development of deep frying. Olive oil can be heated to a much greater temperature than Britain's indigenous frying agents. The higher the heat, the crisper the batter, or potato, or whatever is fried in it will be, and the less they will absorb the oil. Britain adopted deep frying without possessing the essential ingredient. This is the first, but by no means last, instance we shall see of inappropriate imports, of approximations.
Britain's indigenous deep-frying agents are animal fats, beef dripping and pork lard, both of which seem to ensure a soggy, saturated chip. Britain does not, of course, use horse fat, which is widely employed in Belgium, Germany and northern France. It's a way of using up the entire horse, everything but the whinny. However, the British are a selectively fastidious people who prefer not to exploit horse as meat. Why not? Because our sentimentality about species is as inconsistent as our squeamishness about what parts of the animal we're willing to eat. We do not knowingly eat horse or spleen. We do not knowingly eat donkey or duodenum. Yet we do eat fast food.
Which is one of the several paradoxes of British gastronomy. Though gastronomy may not be quite the right word.
We have very little idea of what goes into fast food, and its presentation doesn't prompt us to ask. The primary requirement of fast food is that it should be visually appealing.
Appearance is paramount. Britain eats with its eyes rather than with its tongue. Visual appeal is achieved by presenting the stuff in simple geometrical forms which obliterate any connection with the source of the food.
A batten of battered fish is an abstraction. Processed food is disguised food. There is no visual link between a perfectly round beef burger and the former bull whose meat it is composed of.
Equally, the names beef and pork are euphemisms which obliterate the link to the animals they come from. The word pork allows us to forget that a perfectly cylindrical sausage is composed of pig, mostly.
Small wonder I am crying. I can smell that mum is frying. I got reason to be grizzling. My late dad's in there sizzling. I'm still a pig, but they are pork. A meaty treat for a knife and fork.
Heaven's pasture. From sty to mouth. A treat in a skin.
The sales of Heaven's Pasture sausages famously slumped when this advertisement explicitly linked the supposedly edible product to the death of animals. I'm now going to show you how to make what is mysteriously known as the Great British Banger, although only a nation with a collectively defective palate could possibly deem this aberration great. This is the first essential ingredient.
The second essential ingredient is MRM. This interesting product must be cooked at an extremely high temperature to kill the bacteria in the excrement, which it invariably includes. MRM stands for mechanically recovered meat. It is the animal death industry's name for abattoir slurry. The food biz may not possess much aptitude for edible product, but it certainly has a memorable talent for evasive euphemism.
The third ingredient is a rich cocktail of flavour enhancers, colourants, stabilisers, emulsifiers, preservatives, hydrogenators. The fast food industry is a department of the chemical industry.